chat.
So do I. And one of those promotion bots. So, today we are going to be playing Beacon Pines, and I believe that we're going to, be finishing up the game here. It's hard to tell exactly how far we are through it, but, at points it's seemed like we've been, about 75% of the way through at some points and 50% of the way through at other points. It's a little confusing because you go back and forth through time in the game in a way. Rewriting past events. But yeah. Anyhow, this music is quite loud here. Turn that down a bit. There we go. Better. Alright, so I'm just gonna start the game up here. And put myself down here in the corner so I'm not blocking it. Okay. Just one second. Synchronizing the Steam Cloud. All right. Here we go. All right. Beacon Pines. Forgot to click on the game.
Chapter 6.
Chapter 6.
Secret lair.
That's an interesting way of spelling lair. So in the last episode, the three of us, the three children, were in the treehouse, and there was an interesting piece of information which was revealed, that the grandmother had shown up, I don't remember what they said, weeks or months, a few weeks or a few months after the kid's, Luca's mother had disappeared. And, that immediately set off, alarm bells. Like, maybe there's, something going on with her. But, at the same time, it could just be a misdirection. An attempt to make us suspect the grandmother. But maybe she's not actually, maybe she's not actually a bad guy. Maybe she really is Luca's grandmother. We don't know yet. Anyway.
Summer forged ahead, but the nights only seemed to grow colder.
Summer forged ahead, but the nights only seemed to grow colder. That's... Huh. Previous timelines didn't seem to indicate a lot of time had passed. It was like a few days. Sounds like a longer period of time is passing now. But that doesn't make a lot of sense considering previous events.
Luca walked home slowly under the pale starlight, cautious to avoid any more surprises lurking in the shadows.
I mean, maybe when they say summer forged ahead, they're just... Just talking about one day passing. I don't know.
Reaching home, he slipped quietly into bed, half dreading what they might discover the next day.
Yeah, okay, maybe they weren't talking about a long time passing. What time is it? You don't even give me an option. Not putting that on. Yeah. Bang. Nope. Rilla, what on earth is that? Hmm? That ridiculous thing on your head. Oh, this. It helps me think. You're gonna need a lot more of those. Joke all you want. We'll see who's laughing when I crack this case wide open. The coast is clear? Yep, whatever she's been up to this week, it's been keeping her busy most of the day. Very well. So now it does seem like more than a day has passed. Oh well, it's the time in this game is not, they're not very clear about how much time passes. The game is afoot.
Luca and Beck rolled their eyes as Rollo strutted across the room.
If I were a Gran... Good, why am I yawning again? How come every time I start streaming, I start yawning? If I were a Gran, where would I hide my deepest, darkest secrets? Perhaps where you might least expect it.
Rollo flung open the cabinet with confidence.
Aha!
He coughed as a veil of dust hit his face.
I think it's safe to assume anything that dusty isn't what we're looking for. Or maybe that's what he wants you to think. Then again, any good detective knows not to trust their first hunch. First hunches are for suckers. Eureka! She's lit a fire in order to burn the evidence. She keeps that fire going every day, Rollo. Drat, it may already be too late. Just think of the mounds of documents lost to ash. Okay. I'm gonna stop you right there. Can we just think for a moment? Luca, is there anywhere Gran doesn't want you to go? Yeah, the closet upstairs. So maybe it stands to reason that we should check there first? No dice, it's locked. Well, well, well. Look who stands to reason now. And I have no idea where the key is. If it really is important, then she probably keeps it with her. Anywhere else? She has her berry bushes. Who has ever thought, I'm going to take this important thing and huck it in a bush? True. Anything else? Maybe something out of the ordinary? Well, she is always worried I'll break her fancy dishware in the kitchen. But it doesn't really matter. I can't reach the latch.
A look of realization crept onto Luca's face. All three kids snapped to glance at each other, then sprinted in turn toward the kitchen.
All right, Rollo. This is your time to shine. Ah, yes. You've called upon my expert detective skills, and now I shall proceed with breaking the dishes.
Before he could finish, Lucas scrambled up Rollo's back.
Hey, this isn't my idea of detective work. Every squad needs a good lockpick. Every good lockpick needs a sturdy head to sit on. This is beneath my standing. Stop complaining and hold still. Got it.
The three crowded around the hutch to peer in. With the glass doors opened, a perfect porcelain display gleamed in front of them. Their eyes searched for anything amiss. But the only distinct feature was its impeccability.
Well, that was anticlimactic. Yeah. I don't really know what we were expecting. Like, oh hey. Just let me yank on this random teacup
as
and...
Beck pulled on one of the teacups, it slanted forward with a hollow click. The entire hutch began to rustle and slide under its own power.
You gotta be kidding me. It seems like your gran has been doing some remodeling. Dude, only two types of people have secret lairs. Evil masterminds and superheroes. So which one do you think she is? We're about to find out. Okay, so more of an unhinged conspiracist vibe? Oh, wow. Yeah, this cannot be good. We need to look around before jumping to conclusions. Huh. Well, what do we have here? Barrels marked caution, explosive, and jam jars? That's enough jam to feed the whole town. What kind of incendiary jam is your gran making? Incendiary. She wouldn't have had me walk around town delivering bombs, would she? Right? Only one way to find out.
Rollo casually spun open a lid and dipped his finger in the jam.
Huckleberries.
He smacked his lips.
And a hint of brown sugar. And ink? What?
Rollo plunged his hand in the jar, fishing out a soggy slip of paper.
Aha!
Rollo offered the slimy note to Luca and licked his fingers clean.
It's addressed to Miss Fratelli. A grand jam gram? It says, last night I used the disguise Eris provided to scout the location. The timing window should be possible. Operation Sparkplug is a go. Aw man, are they doing a heist? So... Based on this, I am guessing that Operation Sparkplug is Gran planning to blow up the source. That's why this explosives are in here. And that would also explain the two kids in the treehouse freezing solid the day of the festival. That would suggest that Gran's intention is to blow up the source on the day of the festival, and that causes a chain reaction that kills everybody. Probably. Whatever it is, it can't be good. So, more a bombshell than a bomb, am I right? You're new here, so I'll let it slide. But I'm the bad joke guy around here.
Luca jostled each cabinet drawer in turn. Only one was unlocked. He fingered through the filing cabinet, pausing at a bulging folder labeled Walter. For a long moment, he just stared at it.
I believe Walter's his dad. What do you got there? It's my dad. Looks like some of his old medical files. Your dad was a doctor?
Luca nodded and caressed the label with his thumb.
Well, are you gonna read it? Here, let me help.
Rollo swiped the folder from the drawer and began leafing through the pages. He whistled to himself, barely looking at the text.
How would you actually read some of it? One sec. Dense documents such as this are a lot like a cheeseburger. It's best to skip straight to the middle. That's where all the meaty bits live. Wow, I had no idea we were in the presence of the preeminent scholar in dense documents and cheeseburgers. By all means, proceed.
She stopped at a page and mimed holding up a monocle.
Aha, here we are. Follow-up examination of Terence Wilby. Patient shows further signs of paleness and malaise. Body temperature continues to drop. He now describes soreness of muscles and joints. This is similar to the symptoms exhibited by Miss Wilby just a few days past. Still waiting on lab results from Joseph.
Rolla looked up with heightened surprise.
See? Creepy. Yeah, that's kind of disturbing. Who's Joseph? That's Mr. Nuncreed's name. Wait.
Rolla's finger traced across the page.
There's more scribbled on the margins. Could it be contagious? Mr. Wilby claims the tap water at his home has been contaminated. Perhaps environmental? Lab results only raise more questions. It's like he came back to this report later and made those notes. So it might be related to something else.
Rolo scanned through several more pages.
Here. The writing looks shaky. I just couldn't help her. This disease, or whatever it is, progresses so fast. And with his wife passing, Terrence's condition follows close behind. Exacerbated by the loss. Enough is enough. I need to take matters into my own hands.
Luca, staring blankly at the cabinet this whole time, spoke softly.
What does it say next?
Rolla rustled the folder, trying to loose more pages.
That's where it ends. What? There has to be more!
Luca frantically shoved the remaining cabinet folders, trying to find another labeled Walter.
Luca, I think that's the only one. It's alphabetical, see? What did he mean, enough is enough? How did he take matters into his own hands? This is bullshit!
Luca slammed the drawer shut. A spiderweb of string connected photos of people from the town, interspersed with hastily scrawled notes.
Well, she sure has kept herself busy. Is your gran a serial killer? 'Cause I'm starting to vibe. Oh, hello, Cage. Whoops. Don't be ridiculous. Sure, she's just tracking the movements of everyone in town. Out of the kindness of her heart, she put little symbols by some of them. Yeah, Mr. Nuncreed has a check mark. The clipboards are all inside a big circle. My moms are both on here. Both with question marks. Gus Valentine has a question mark. Eris has a question mark that's been crossed out. Mr. Kerr has a bullseye. The killer has chosen her next victim! We don't know what any of this means. Whatever it means, it's probably not good. What's this saying? Huh. Come on! Give me a... I need an achievement! Verb! Damn it.
They crowded around a worn-down old map of Beacon Pines.
Cool. This looks like a treasure map. Not every old map is a treasure map, Rolo. Yeah, but every treasure map is an old map. Can't fault that logic. Look, there's even a pathway drawn on it. It starts at the entrance to town. And if we follow it...
Rolo carefully traced the path with his finger.
It leads right to...
He jabbed down at the end point.
Town Square? That's the fountain in the middle of town. What a weird place to hide treasure. Rolo, that doesn't look like treasure to me. The end of the path on that map has the same symbols as explosives over there. So it's not hiding treasure. A real bummer. Rolo, what's the thing you've been excited about for the past month? The festival! Gulp. Did you just say gulp? This feels like a gulp kind of situation. Everyone will be gathered near the center of town. She's gonna blow up the festival! Not if we stop her. What was that?
Luca looked up from the map.
What was that? No, I heard it too. That was the front door. Which means someone just shut the door. Which means someone's upstairs. Shh, quiet. Hit the lights.
Beck flicked off the light, and they became statues in the dark.
The cabinet is still wide open.
Overhead, creaking floorboards bent under slow, deliberate steps. The kids looked up, the tilt of their necks following each footfall. Then suddenly, it stopped. Without realizing, they'd been holding their breath. All three exhaled shakily and glanced at each other. A muffled male voice broke the silence.
Oh, I recognize that face.
A final few footsteps reached the entrance above them, and the voice now echoed down the stairs.
Hello.
Anyone down there?
The three kids shuffled to the corners without a peep. As he began to descend the stairs, the man's voice punctuated every new step. Thump.
Yoo-hoo!
Thump.
I'm not here to hurt anyone.
Thump.
I'm just here to help.
Thump.
Just...
Thump. At the bottom step, the man paused, squinting to search the room for signs of life.
Huh. Guess it's nothing.
Rolo shifted suddenly. Luca gave him an intense, chastising look and whispered through clenched teeth.
Rolo, don't.
It was too late. Rolo was already inching toward the stairway. He screeched as he charged toward the shadowy figure.
Flaming chicken coop!
With all his weight, Rolo tackled the man to the ground.
Rolo? Mystery creepy man? Anyone there?
From the dark corner, they saw something move.
Oh, I didn't know if I had it in me. But there was only one way to find out. Holy crap, Rolo, that was awesome. Wait, did you just kill that person?
Luca scrambled to the hunched figure on the ground. Pressing his fingers to the man's neck, he sighed with relief.
You sure clobbered him good, Rolo. He's knocked out
as
cold.
As Beck flicked back on the light, Luca and Rolo both gasped in stereo.
Mr. Tolliver!
Chapter 7. The interrogation of Hiram Tolliver. Still unconscious, Mr. Tolliver slumped heavily in a shoddy old chair. His hands were bound with rope, his feet tied with some loose string. The kids huddled in a circle, discussing their plan. One thing was certain, they couldn't just let Mr. Tolliver go. They needed to know what he was doing in Lucas' house. After some deliberation, it was decided.
They run the classic good cop, blank cop interrogation. Good cop, chill cop. Hard cop.
They'd run the classic good cop, hard cop interrogation. Rollo brandished a steely gaze. I've got this. Read about it 100 times. Rollo swaggered past the chair which propped up the slumping Hiram Tolliver. Without even looking at his captive, he began with a long, blustery drawl.
Well, well, Mr. Tolliver.
Mr. Tolliver remained motionless. Rollo spun around to face him. He'd clearly expected to rouse Mr. Tolliver with his booming voice.
Mr. Tolliver?
Beck and Luca gave each other an unsure glance. Rollo slammed his fist on the table.
I said, Mr. Tolliver!
He grabbed the table lamp and beamed it onto the unconscious face. Mr. Tolliver groaned and slowly lifted his head. He recoiled with a muddled, weary squint.
What in the world?
The chair wobbled as he attempted to straighten up.
Who's there?
Mr. Tolliver could only make out rough shapes through the glaring light. With a gruff tone, Rollo hoped to both conceal his voice and intimidate.
Well, they're asking the questions here, punk. Now hold on, let's just calm down. Oh, I am calm. Calm's a carrot in dirt. As for you, looks like you're sweating.
The doubtful expression on Beck and Lucas' faces transformed into awe.
We can do this my way, or... well... let's just say I've never needed another way.
Rollo, hitting his stride, was now channeling every detective trope his memory could recall. He slammed the table again.
Now dance! What? I don't even...
Mr. Tolliver's voice became desperate. He was nearly in tears.
You've tied me down. How on earth can I dance? Dance with your mouth, punk. Spill the beans! What are you doing poking around this house? I'm here to help Juniper. To make sure everything's ready. Oh, so you're in cahoots with Gran? Gran?
Mr. Tolliver was in a daze, now more confused than ever.
Gonna help her blow up the festival, eh? Blow up the festival? Good lord!
He shook his head, feeling more and more dizzy.
No, you've got it all wrong. Where is she now? She's headed to the source. Source? What's the source? It's where...
his voice faded to a whisper.
The town began. Where it all began. What is Operation Sparkplug?
With that, Mr. Tolliver passed out cold. Rollo swung around with a repentant grimace.
Damn, Rollo. I think you went a little too hard on him. What did you say about the source? It's where the town began? We need more information. Yeah, but we'd better not push Mr. Tolliver any farther. Is there anyone else who might know more? What about the History Museum? No supremacy. Didn't type that. Left my phone at the table. It just got set up for the festival. Nah, that tent was put up by the Valentines. Everything they do is just a bunch of fluff to glorify themselves. Is there anything more reliable? A library. If there's any information about the source thing, Cato can help us find it. Let's go get some answers. This is a dang nice library. Thanks, we work hard on it. Aren't you a little young to be a librarian? Kato hung out here so much, eventually they gave us out of keys. I just keep an eye on the place for Miss Novak sometimes. They get you working for free? It's quiet, and I get access to all the books I can read. What more could a person want? Fair enough. What can I do for y'all? We need a favor. I already told you in Rolo. I can't put you any higher on the wait list for the next Atomic. Hank Atomic. And if you're here with more candy, I'll have you know I can't be bought. Call it a personal code of conscience. Actually, we're looking to do some research. Now you're speaking my language. What are you looking for? That's the thing, we sort of don't know. What do you get out of the history of the town? Huh? There's the county record archives. What's in those? Births, deaths, newspaper clippings, stuff like that. Pretty boring reading. But they do all the way back to when the town was founded. Great, we'll start there.
Chapter 8. 6 feet under, three towns over.
Three towns over.
The kids spent the rest of the afternoon combing through dusty piles of old county records, desperately searching for anything that could help them make sense of Mr. Tolliver's cryptic utterance.
There couldn't possibly be three copies of Beacon Pines, could there?
Luca tried to shake the thought of Gran's basement, but his focus wavered. Explosives, messages hidden in jam, dossiers on various town figures, and a corkboard threaded with photos. Gran was the only family he had left. He still couldn't bring himself to believe the worst. But the old map with the symbol of explosives in town square made that difficult. As the sun began to set, the kids were no closer to the truth.
If I have to read any more records, my eyeballs are gonna pop. We have to keep digging. If I dig another word, I'm gonna end up in one of those asinine death records. Rollo Cotter lived a full and wonderful life till he read so much boring cred that his brain oozed out of his ears.
Rollo shut his book with an assertive nod.
If you got a better idea, spit it out. You sound like my sister. Keep pushing your luck, pal. And it won't be boring county records that kill you. I'll put you in the obituaries myself.
Rollo muttered under his breath.
You're a county record. Really? That's the best you've got? When I'm done with you, you'll be the footnote in history. Just like
Beck slammed her finger down on the open page before glancing down to read.
J. Hartford here. I'd love to see you try. Hey. We're all a little tired here. Let's just take a minute and
Something tickled the back of Luca's mind.
Wait, what was that name back? Inuit Jay Hartford. From the Brookville Tribune 8 years ago. That can't be right. What is it? Jay Hartford. That's my grand's name, Juniper Hartford. Uh-oh. Maybe there were two Jay Hartfords? Miss Hartford is survived by her young daughter, E. Hartford. My mom's name is Eleanor. Okay, this is getting creepy. If your gran is 6 feet under, three towns over, then who am I living with?
The question hung in the air.
All right, gang. I gotta close up for the night.
Beck rubbed her eyes.
How late is it? Almost 10. Oh, crap. Pa is gonna kill me. I gotta go. Yeah, my parents will be worried sick. Okay, let's meet up as early as we can at the festival tomorrow. What are you gonna do about the unconscious man in your basement? I'll think of something.
Luca's heart was pounding as he approached the house. If he was lucky, Gran, or whoever it was, hadn't gotten back yet. And of course, there was Mr. Tolliver tied up and unconscious in the basement. Dealing with him would be the first order of business. Luca shook out his arms to calm his nerves before entering. He held perfectly still, tempering his breath, and listened closely. She was asleep. His only hope was that she hadn't found Mr. Tolliver before dozing off.
Oh no.
Mr. Tolliver was nowhere to be seen.
Maybe he woke up, escaped from his bindings, and left without a trace?
Or maybe Gran knew everything.
What do I do?
Luca's hungry stomach groaned. Not realizing it, he'd gone the entire day without eating.
Okay, I can figure this out. Just need a little brain food.
Luca rushed over to the pile of jam jars, unscrewed one, and shoveled a handful into his mouth.
I'm afraid your jam delivery will be delayed.
He flipped the lid to read the label.
Mr. Nuncreed. Uh-oh. Okay, now I can think. I don't have a good feeling about the jam they just ate. So if Grant knows we tied up Mr. Tolliver, I'm screwed. If she doesn't know, then I need to play it cool. I guess the only option is to go to bed and act as if nothing is wrong. Grant will think Mr. Tolliver finished what he was sent to do and left when he was done. Gran will definitely not hear this, right? Can I activate that to close it? No. Nothing out here still? Stick to the plan. Go to bed. Play it cool.
As Luca climbed the final stair, the emotion of the day dragged heavily on him. With each consecutive step, his legs weakened. His stride began to falter.
Uh-oh.
He tried to grab for the railing to steady himself. Something was wrong.
It's the jam! Come on, legs. Just a few more steps.
Luca groaned and tried to move. His limbs might as well have been bolted to the ground. Through numb lips, he mumbled just before falling asleep.
The germ. Successfully went to sleep. Sweet boy. What did you get yourself into? Rest now, and let me handle everything. Uh-oh.
Chapter 9. A speech to end all speeches. Luca awoke to find himself face down in bed. He moaned into his pillow. Why would Gran drug him?
Why would Gran drug him? Gran didn't drug him. You ate the fucking jam on your own.
Or rather, why was she trying to drug Mr. Nuncrete?
Exactly.
Shaking the questions from his woozy head, Luca snapped back to the matter at hand.
The festival! Still locked. I wonder if this thing is open. It's still open. Why would Gran leave that wide open? Did she not go and check on it? Where have you been? Gran put something in the jam. Yeah, we know. Secret messages for secret conspirators. Not this one. The one intended for Mr. Nuncrete. Put me to sleep. Whoa. Sly devil. Sly. I think she's trying to remove him from the equation. He might be in danger. Have you found anything? We looked around but haven't seen anything odd. Your Gran is nowhere to be found. But Mr. Nuncrete is just loafing around, waiting for the speech. What speech? Mayor Gus just got up to the podium. Everyone's gathering at the stage. We didn't get to find out what the kids did to that sign. They said that they changed it. Wow, everybody's here.
Augustus Valentine nervously wiped his brow.
And here's where everybody freezes solid. Hey, look at little bunnies. Just looking to see who's here. Oh, the little bat. Mahem. Is this thing? Hello, Beacon Pines. I'm Augustus Valentine, your mayor, and I suppose you already know that. Oh yes, before we get started, I just wanted to take a moment to recognize someone who couldn't be here today. This town wouldn't be where it is today without my father, Sharper Valentine. So I thought we could begin with a round of applause, befitting such a great man. He Even that's more than the old codger deserved.
Gus cleared his throat and awkwardly loosened his tie.
Right, where was I?
William Kerr bounded on the stage with the energy of a preacher at a big tent revival.
Gus Valentine, everyone!
He gave Gus a hearty slap on the back and motioned him off the stage.
Let's hear it for our mayor. What a great turnout. Aw, heck, I didn't prepare anything. Except this 200-word, meticulously prepared speech. But I suppose I could say a few words. It would be a shame to waste such a beautiful podium.
Mr. Kerr pulled a thick stack of note cards out from his vest.
Community, conviction, commitment. These are the things we celebrate at Perennial Harvest. For us, these are the pillars of the bridge to a better tomorrow. But I think it's time to add a new pillar. Change. Change is a powerful thing. It's inexorable, unavoidable, and undeniable. And I am dadgum thankful for it. Change is the reason we're all together today. It's hard for me to believe that it was only 4 years ago when fate brought me here. A simple business trip which brought me to a small town which would change my life forever.
Mr. Kerr took a moment to survey the crowd.
You know what?
He wiped away a single tear.
From the second I set foot in Beacon Pines, something about this place has held me captive. Literally. You see, change represents opportunity. It represents potential. It was change that helped me recognize the potential of this place. To see that the people of this town, despite suffering great loss, still held on to the things that made them special.
To emphasize each word.
Community, conviction, commitment, change.
Mr. Kerr nodded confidently, biting his lip. The crowd was silent, in rapt attention.
Fate made a perfect match that day. Nothing is more important to all you all than community. And Perennial Harvest is a community first and foremost.
Mr. Kerr methodically made eye contact with each section of the crowd.
The only way you made it through the foul harvest was an unshakable conviction. A conviction that a better tomorrow was just over the horizon. Perennial Harvest was founded on the conviction that we are that horizon. This festival is a symbol of our commitment to each other.
To build to a crescendo.
We now walk hand in hand into a future we will shape together. And that is what change is all about. Grabbing the future by the balls, I mean the scruff of the neck, and making things happen. Change is a choice. I am tickled pink that we will be making that choice together. How great is that? Just imagine what we can accomplish. Uh-oh. What was that?
The crowd began to look around nervously.
Don't worry, a little thunder ain't gonna ruin this day. Everyone remain calm.
Mr. Kerr quickly flicked through his note cards.
Where was I? Through all my travels, I've learned one true thing. One always reaps what they sow. We have all planted a lot of good in this town, and so it is with a happy heart I can proclaim...
He raised his hands up to the heavens.
Our harvest away!
At that moment, a merciless wall of impossibly
cold I saw that coming.
Ripped through the crowd, instantly freezing everyone and everything it touched. For a man like William Kerr, this was a fitting way for things to end. On a stage, with an entire town frozen in rapt attention for the rest of time. The end. There's that ice again! Whenever I think we're getting close, it comes along and ruins everything! Maybe we should just quit? Maybe you should just close the book, walk away, and never think of me again!
Maybe.
No, I don't mean that. We got a little closer this time. We just need to try again. Please.
Still.
Let's see what I got here.
Huh. I've gotten so many different verbs recently. Like, I got 2 or 3 new verbs. But, it hasn't opened up any new paths, except for, oh. I guess I have... Huh. So I have a new... option. I can, before I had only the chill option to integrate chill and hard, and now I have sly as well. I wonder which option I should take. Eventually, I assume I'm gonna get another one for this one. So what should I do? I assume if I do the chill option, that's going to be one that doesn't lead very far. It'll probably still cause the, the town will probably still freeze over. We might get some new information, so maybe I'll do that one.
They'd run the classic good cop, chill cop interrogation.
I'll handle this. So I bet the last one, with the little black cat there, will be the sly one. I'll handle this. Just gonna play it cool.
Luca walked calmly to the light switch, flicking it off and on a few times. Mr. Tolliver shook his head, gathering his wits.
Golly, I sure got my bell rung.
He looked over to find Luca, who returned a calming grin.
Sorry, Mr. Tolliver. This was all a big mistake. Luca, what's going on here? Why do you have me strapped down? No one's fault, really. Rollo just got a little startled. Rollo's here?
Rollo and Beck emerged from hiding to give a timid wave.
Well, all right. Mistakes happen. You kids gave old Haram a good scare. Let's just get me out of these ropes and call it even.
Luca glanced over to Rollo and Beck, who replied with skeptical looks.
Mr. Tolliver, why are you in my grand's basement? I'm here to help, of course. Help with what? What's my gran up to? If you'll just cut me loose, I can show you. How do I know we can trust you?
Mr. Tolliver exhaled with disappointment.
Luca, have I ever done wrong by you? No. And since your gran moved to town, haven't I been nothing but welcoming? Yeah. So why would I turn my back on your family now? It's just... all this stuff seems pretty weird. A board with names of people from town, an archive of my dad's old disturbing patient notes.
Luca gestured to the corner.
Barrels of explosives. I can explain everything. You just need to untie me. You kids deserve an explanation.
Luca looked again to Rollo and Beck. This time they shrugged. Luca began to slowly loosen the bindings. Mr. Tolliver gently rubbed his wrists.
That's a good lad. Uh-oh. This all makes sense in time. Oh, he's backing up.
He edged imperceptibly toward the stairs.
I wouldn't
as he spoke.
Exactly call that imperceptibly. I very clearly noticed him take a step back. You see, this town has secrets, Luca. A very dark past indeed.
Before the kids had even noticed his movement, Mr. Tolliver was at the light switch.
These kids are very imperceptive, considering they're extremely perceptive about everything else. He's literally moved 6 feet. A past that must be brought to dark?
He punctuated his final words by flicking the switch and rushing up the stairs.
Light! Son of a...
Beck darted to the wall and turned back on the lights. It was too late. Rollo confirmed what they all heard.
He just locked us down here.
Mr. Tolliver's muffled voice came from behind the door.
I wasn't lying, you know. This is for your own good. You kids just keep tight down there, and let the adults handle this.
They looked bewildered at each other.
Play it cool, huh? Not now, Beck.
They heard the staccato thump of quick steps exiting the house. The kids looked down in resignation. This isn't how it goes in Hank Atomic. For some reason, they'd always assumed it was up to them to save their town. Luca opened his mouth, hoping to conjure some magical words to make this right.
Avada Kedavra!
Only a hollow croak escaped. The end. Well, we certainly aren't going to find a grand resolution to our tale locked in a basement. Back to the drawing board.
I knew it. I knew that would be the short one. All right, time for the sly approach.
They'd run the classic good cop, sly cop interrogation. Luca and Rollo ducked behind a barrel, leaving Beck to her task. With a few crisp snaps, she roused Mr. Tolliver.
What? What's going on here? You. You're that Mogwill girl. Please, call me Beck. Sorry about all this.
Mr. Tolliver looked down and shifted a bit, testing his restraints.
Seems there's been a mix-up. You see, I'm down here for the same reason you are. Juniper sent you here?
Beck caught herself before letting the surprise manifest on her face. She'd already gotten him to reveal his relation to Gran. This was gonna be easy.
You know how Juniper is with her precautions. Operation Sparkplug has us all on edge. I guess she thought you needed some backup. But she sent a child? What better way to avoid prying eyes? Who would suspect a kid? I suppose that makes sense.
Mr. Tolliver wriggled a bit in his restraints.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Quickly removed the ropes.
What? No, don't do that. That had to be uncomfortable. A little, yeah. But you understand.
We never know who to trust in this town.
Mr. Tolliver rubbed the growing knot on his forehead.
Very true. So it turns out we're both here to...
Beck twirled her hand, as if to prompt Mr. Tolliver to finish her thought.
Destroy the evidence.
Beck shook her head and clicked her tongue.
Yep, the old gal is nothing if not thorough.
Mr. Tolliver let out an amused huff in agreement.
She sure is. Can't blame her, though. If anyone were to find out that we're going to destroy the source... Well, we know both know how bad that might be. No one will know anything once I finish cleaning things up down here.
Beck was on a roll now, playing Mr. Tolliver like a fiddle.
You're sure you can finish this up on your own? Juniper trusted me for a reason. You can leave the rest to me. Good. There is one more loose end I'll go work on. Loose end? Oh, it's nothing really. The other day I had the radio on scan while restocking this candy shelf. And wouldn't you know it, I intercepted an odd phrase in a perennial harvest transmission. Underground secrets. That's ominous. I think it might be a password, but Juniper dismissed it. She said it wasn't mission critical. What's the password for? We don't know. So we have a password and know where to put it? It's gonna mean something, right? Good thinking. You should probably go work that out. I've got this under control. That's a relief. Between you and me, this basement gives me the willies.
Heading for the stairs, Mr. Tolliver hesitated and turned to Beck with a puzzled look. She grinned and gave him a peppy wave. With a shrug, he continued up the stairs, whistling a jaunty tune.
You guys catch that? Sure did. This whole time, Mr. Tolliver's had a candy shelf. But all he ever sells us is apples!
Beck blinked slowly in disappointment.
The password, Rolo. Well, sure, but once things are back to normal, we'll be having a word with Mr. Tolliver about that candy shelf. Fine. In the meantime, I've got an idea.
She turned to the table and began tearing small scraps of paper.
He said he heard a password on the radio. Any good spy transmission is never what it seems.
Beck marked each scrap of paper and leaned back.
We just need to find the hidden meaning. Okay. What's another word for underground? Buried? Covered? Could it be a cover-up? Maybe it's one of those each letter is a number things. So you would be 21. N would be 14. D would be... Ooh. It's an anagram. Nun Creed's Drugstore.
Luca and Beck looked at Rolo with amazement.
Rolo, that was incredible. Well, it's either that or Kren's new drugstore. Yeah, I think you were right the first time. How did you do that? What can I say? I love ciphers. Well, I guess we know where to go next. I like this music. Oh, what's this? Oh, just another place I can lean and chill. I don't understand what the point is of those. Just a chill spot. Oh, oh shit. Hello? You scared me half to death. Sorry. You kids haven't seen Mr. Tolliver around, have you? Nope.
She kept me waiting around like the last slice of pie. I swear that man would be late to his own funeral. We're not gonna find out what this fucking sign says until the end of the game. It better be something good. Oh shit. You're late, Augustus. Sorry, sister. Caught up with work. Work? You? I had a few more details to lock down for the festival. Oh? What do you have to report? What is this insipid town festival really about? I think...
Gus looked around nervously.
I think Mr. Kerr really does just want to do something good for the town. He's actually a pretty nice guy. You should spend some time with him. I didn't pull strings installing you as mayor so that you could make friends. Your job is to help me figure out what Kerr and Perennial Harvest's true intentions are with this town. We have a responsibility. This is our father's town. Was. Excuse me? This was our father's town. He's gone, Eris, and he isn't coming back. Father left us with nothing but problems. Mr. Kerr came here and offered to help us. We accepted that help. We didn't agree to them turning Father's warehouse into a toxic dumping ground. That is just a temporary arrangement. The glow can be seen from our damned backyard. They're dumping their nasty little secrets on us. When all this inevitably goes wrong, who do you think will be blamed?
Eris's cry hung in the air.
We have a new choice to make now, sister. This town is going to change, whether we like it or not. Are we going to choose to be a part of that future? Or be forgotten in the past? It's a shame. Father named you Augustus, but you'll always just be a Gus. Good night, Eris. I'll see you at the breakfast tomorrow. It's getting late, children. There it is, Uncreate's drugstore.
Solomon stood proudly at the entrance to the drugstore, holding a brown bag overflowing with black licorice.
Hey, Solomon. We're looking for Mr. Uncreate. Is he still in there? I'm afraid not. Then where'd you get the candy from? You might say, we have an arrangement.
Solomon shoveled a surprising amount of licorice into his mouth.
Sometimes it's the small pleasures in life. Though we might not always have family to rely on, licorice has never let me down. Well, I can't say licorice would be my first choice. But whatever floats your boat. You can tell a lot about a person by their choice of confection. Oh, yeah, I guess. I like sour gobs. I'm certain you do. I always wondered why Mr. Uncreate kept licorice in stock. You must eat enough of it to make it worthwhile. There are many ways to earn loyalty. For some, it's as easy as cold hard cash. Well, he's right. It's locked. There's gotta be more clues. Okay, let's see. Have you actually seen anyone use this thing? Besides Mr. Nuncreed? No.
Beck cupped her hands on the glass to peek inside.
That is not a normal phone booth. It's got, like, a blinky keypad. Why would there be a blinky keypad? Kren's new drugstore! I mean, underground secrets! The password!
Beck flung open the door, and they all squeezed in.
Alright, let's see here.
Luca cracked his knuckles and entered the letters into the keypad.
Underground secrets. Sounds like that did something. Great, now what? I guess we...
Ah! The dropped loose from its shell. Without even the space to panic, they closed their eyes, held their breath, and accepted their fate. Suddenly, the chaotic descent slowed to an effortless landing. It was unclear where they ended up, but at least it was solid ground.
Mm.
The air was stagnant and smelled vaguely of chlorine.
Cool. I'll be right back in a moment. Some gummy worms. Alright. I knew it. You knew there was a secret hub full of strange tubes under the phone booth? Of course I did. Didn't I say that? No. Definitely thought it. Luca, do you remember when I said how cool it would be if the trans-dimensional conduits from Hank's Atomic Issue number 12 were real? Rollo, at one point or another, you said that about every technology ever discussed in Hank Atomic. That's why I'm such a good predictor. Looks like each of these has something written on them. So read them.
Mining Operations Alpha. You guys have mines here? Not that I know of. This town's all farms and fertilizer. Canisters of tubes. But always says you can only trust a miner up to the point when they hit gold. Not sure how that wisdom applies in this exact situation. Think about Pi, you don't always realize what he needs until it's too late. Perennial Harvest, main office. That's where my mom works. What does she do? Science stuff. Is she involved in all this? He just moved here. How could she be involved? True. Valentine Fertilizer Warehouse. Isn't that where you almost got snatched? Yeah. Why would Perennial Harvest have a tube going to the old Valentine place? This is starting to feel like something big. This dude has a broken mask. So have we found our mystery warehouse creeper? We at least found their hazmat suit. It walks like a Nuncreed and talks like a Nuncreed. Let's not jump to conclusions. Just saying. That's a lot of buttons. Stand aside, Earthlings. I've heard enough Hank Atomic to know my way around sci-fi tech.
Rollo's hands hovered over the field of blinking buttons.
Eeny, meeny, miny. Rollo, what did you do? Nothing. I didn't even mow yet. What was that? Hide! Where? It's nothing but weird tubes down here. Just get back! Uh-oh. Shit. 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 Awesome! You all need to come with me now. We aren't going anywhere with you. Not until we get some answers. That's our underground secrets. Told them that was an absurd password. But they love anything that makes them feel clever. They who? That's no matter. If I can keep you hidden until after the festival, might be able to save your skins. We don't care about our skins. Hold on now, I like my skin. This all stops now, Nuncreed.
Joseph waited for a moment in silence.
You sound just like him. Ooh. Wall. You don't get to talk about my dad. You know, your father and I were friends back before.
He gestured toward the strange tubes.
All this. That's a lie. It's true. I used to bounce you on my knee. What happened? Same thing that always happens. We try to take over the world, Pinky. Reality, complications, life. We were a team, Walt and I. An idealistic doctor and a bright-eyed pharmacist. Both hell-bent on helping folks. So you were a sidekick? No. We were partners. He helped the patients, and I helped him. Yep, total sidekick.
None Tancred let out a growl of a sigh.
Luca, I need you to know this. I need someone to know this. One day, Sherbert Valentine comes to us. Says he's got an opportunity. Found something he didn't quite understand. And he was willing to pay us both handsomely to help him understand it. And my dad said no. Your father and I both believed in helping people. But the thing I never could get him to understand was, it's a lot easier to help others if you help yourself now and then. Classic sidekick into villain plotline. Walt loved being righteous, almost more than he loved his family. He was wrong about one thing, though. When he begged me not to take Valentine's offer, he said, "Joseph, if a person says yes one time to Sharper Valentine, he'll make sure they keep on saying yes to him until the day he's dead and gone."
He shook his head wistfully.
Sharper's long gone, but he's still got me saying yes. Is there a point to this sob story? Not really, no. Just an old man trying to delay what needs doing.
Nuncreed took a menacing step towards the children.
I tried to keep you safe. I tried to keep you and Juniper out of this. But you forced my hand.
Luca began to laugh.
What? You really don't know? My Gran isn't out of this. She's been scheming right under your nose. Juniper? Seems like she's planning on crashing the town's party. She's gonna disrupt the festival. Why would she?
The color drained from Nuncreed's face.
How does she know? Apparently she knows a lot of things. What? Let's just say this isn't the only underground lair we've busted into today. And honestly, hers is way cooler. She got maps and explosives and bad intentions, big man.
Nuncreed grabbed Luca by the shoulders. His eyes were frantic.
You needed to tell me what she's going to do right now. She doesn't understand what it is she's messing with. Tell me now. She's in danger, boy. I don't know. She had a map with a mark on the fountain in Town Square. The fountain, but why would...
A jolt of realization struck Mr. Nuncreed.
She knows about the source? What the heck is the source? If she tries to destroy the source, it could catalyze and... Dear God, she's going to freeze us all. You all need to run. Run where? Away. As far away from this town as you can get. Head west and don't look back. That did not go how I expected. So, we're totally following him, right? Totally. See you on the other side. You good? Yep. I love this town.
To yank her into the dark. Dimness eclipsed around her like the shutter of a camera as she seemed to cover great distance in mere moments. Her only points of reference were glints of upcoming turns, which approached with frightening speed, only to carom her gracefully along. She heard the tinny, distant echoes of Rollo's glee. Once she stopped fighting against it, the ride was impossibly smooth. Then, all of a sudden, as if minutes had passed in an instant, light blazed into view. A burst of wintry air snuffed across her face, and she was flung out into the cold.
Oh, that's what that hole was. That was intense. Yeah. I think I might have parted with some fluids in there. Any idea where we are? Somewhere cold. Doesn't look like it got on any of us. Didn't feel like we traveled that far. So where did it all go? This place sucks. Why would anyone even want to blow something up out here? Only one way to find out, I suppose. We gotta catch up to Nuncreed. I think he went this way. Okay, this is starting to feel really familiar. I may not be the most well-versed in all things Beacon Pines, but this does look like some sort of frozen replica of town. Ah, I got it. It's so obvious now. Mr. Nuncreed is an alien. I wonder if aliens are actually going to play a part in this. I mean, the source is a strange technology unknown to man. And they keep on mentioning aliens. And they keep on acting like, haha, aliens is silly. It can't be aliens. I don't know. This game has a very interesting plot so far. It's taken many weird twists and turns. It could totally be aliens. Rolo, stick with me here. His species can only live in sub-zero temperatures. Oh boy, here we go. The source is their base camp dimension, so naturally they keep it cold. We found it by traveling through those metallic wormholes back there. I mean, there's another thing too. Those tubes they travel through are also not normal technology. The final objective, kill us all and shapeshift into a Beacon Pine citizen of their choosing. And also, all of the clipboards look identical. Now, that could just be them reusing the model, for the sake of reusing the model, but it doesn't really seem like that's the vibe they're going for there. They're all talking identically, and I don't know. You never really had me, but you very much lost me there. You get used to it. We should keep moving.
As they rounded the corner to the frozen town square, they spotted Mr. Nuncreed inching cautiously toward a pit at its center. He held his arms out gingerly, as if approaching a beast in the wild. Upon closing the distance, Luca recognized what Nuncreed was after. Gran stood confidently at the edge, one arm outstretched over the abyss. Nearby, a wheelbarrow had been emptied out. She held a lit torch, which flickered in the bitter wind.
Juniper, I don't know what you think you're doing, but I assure you, this is not going to solve anything. If you drop that, you've doomed this whole town. Oh, it wasn't me who doomed this town. I've been watching you, Joseph. I know what you've done. You and your co-conspirators. Gran, what's happening? Luca, you and your friends need to leave right this moment.
Mr. Nuncreed turned back toward the kids. Desperation in his eyes.
Listen to your grandma, Luca. This is between me and Juniper.
Back held steadfast in awe. Luca approached closer. Mr. Nuncreed spun back toward Gran, his voice growing louder.
You got it all wrong, Juniper. Just hand over that torch. You don't understand what you're doing. How could I possibly trust you to do the right thing? Walt told me everything.
He trusted you and you betrayed that trust. Luca, did you know this man's entire life is a lie? If it weren't for him, your father might still be alive.
Mr. Nuncrean winced with anguish. His voice hardened.
That's not true.
They both now yelled, not to each other, but at fate itself, making their peace with long-held burdens. The wind howled with encouragement.
Walt was like a brother to me. We just had different ideas on how to affect change. Very convenient that your way just happened to line your pockets. Now that's not fair.
They menaced at each other, both catching their breath. The moment balanced on a knife's edge. Amid a blur of emotions and memories, Luca's mind flooded with questions. The wind calmed, as if to give him the stage.
And in the stillness, he began to weep. Oh, I just guessed. I didn't even know I had that verb. humming is a weird reaction to this. I'm gonna go for. I'm betting weeping will give me the bad end and hum will give me the good end, so I'm going to go for weep, but I'm probably going to be wrong, and weep is going to be the one that I should have gone for second, but whatever.
Try weep. And in the stillness, he began to weep. It was all just too much. Falling to his knees, Luca whimpered softly. The tears crystallized as they hit the snow. Gran stared at Luca for a moment with warm sympathy, remembering why this was all necessary.
Uh-oh! This will all make sense soon, Luca. Then everything can go back to normal. I promise. Gran, you can't make that promise!
She stiffened up and brandished the torch at Mr. Nuncrete.
You can't hide behind those people any longer, Joseph. Once their precious source is destroyed, we'll see where their loyalties fall. Juniper, don't!
Ignoring his final plea, Gran flung the torch into the deep darkness.
I knew it! Bad end!
She smiled and exhaled in relief. Mr. Nuncrete moaned in resignation.
Oh, God.
The torch echoed as it ricocheted down the hole, punctuated with a thunderous thud.
What have you done? You see, Joseph, I have learned one very important lesson in life. If you want things to change, then you must be willing to...
Before Gran could finish, the ground shook her to silence. Gran only had time to spin around and run to Luca. Her attempt to shield him, an honorable but trifling act. Unflinching love, pitted against an unthinking horror. There was no contest. Her warm embrace froze in an instant. That is where they remain, fixed in place. Forever. And so, our story ends on this melancholy scene.
No!
In a town brought low by its secrets, sits the frozen statues of a misguided band of meddlers. The end.
We're only on page 73, so this isn't really the end.
Well, that was dire. On the bright side, we finally figured out where all the ice is coming from.
I figured that out a while ago.
Now, we just need to find a way to deal with a mystic, unfathomable force of nature.
Yes. All right. So,
Yeah, I don't think I have any, Alright. It's kind of weird that it's gonna come down to humming. But, clearly, there is another branch over here where I, convince Mr. Nuncreed not to, do what he's doing. And that's probably... Also, this tree, based on the size of this, one, two, three, maybe three more branches fit up there at the top. All right, time to hum.
And in the stillness, he began to hum. After the death of his father, Luca had trouble sleeping. Each night, his mother would sit at the foot of his bed and hum a gentle melody. It was the only thing that could calm his mind. The only thing that, however briefly, could make it all seem okay. That melody pervaded every memory Luca had of his mother. Shivering in the raw snow, he began to hum it out loud. Gran lowered the torch, listening closely. As recognition slowly set in, her heart sank. Those countless nights of consolation, the incomparable loss they shared together. She let the torch fall to the snow and sizzle out. A few steps toward Luca was all she could bear before dropping to the snow herself. Through a flood of tears, she began to hum along, note for note.
Am I supposed to do something? It's not pretty clear. All right, I think I need to do something.
Luca lifted his head.
Yeah, okay. How do you know? I'm so sorry, my little buckaroo. Buckaroo? The only people who call me that are my dad and... What? 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 Grandma!
Is mother... Your mother...
Luca blinked through blurry, watery eyes, trying to see more clearly.
But... It's... Did she fall in the goo, become old, and then they had to pretend that she was his grandmother to make everything make sense? And all this time she was just pretending to keep this... But why? Why would she keep that secret if she was... She was trying to figure out what the town was plotting.
He could just make out the impression of a familiar face. He peered across the snowscape at the woman on her knees.
What?
Something about her was undeniably his mother.
What?
Only smaller, older, changed.
Changed? That's a completely different game. Mom? How could you not recognize your own mother, even if she's older? I don't know how old Luca was when his mother disappeared. I think he was, like, 6 when his father died, but then, I don't know if they actually explained, when his mother disappeared precisely. That's right, Buckaroo. What the hell? This game is really good at surprise twists. I'll give it that. Mom? How did I not pick up on that earlier? I mean, we saw the effects of the goo on Beck, the little black cat. It made their hair turn gray when some goo got on them. In another timeline. But, I mean, I don't know. I didn't have any reason to suspect that Gran was his mother. But old.
They held each other close, and the cold retreated from their bodies.
I can't wait to go and watch Caleb's playthrough of this and see how he reacts to these revelations. Oh, I see Caleb is online right now. Eleanor? I thought you were gone. You should have known I would never abandon my son.
Eleanor looked down at Luca, tightening her embrace in an appeal for forgiveness.
How? You're a smart man, Joseph. I thought you'd have pieced it together by now. You were exposed? Mom, I don't understand any of this. What happened to you? Where did you go? Why did you leave me? I never left you. I was always right here, Luca. Why did you lie to me? It tore me up, Luca, but I did it to keep you safe. I thought that getting answers would help us both move on. But the more I discovered, the more I realized the danger we were in. Until perennial harvest was stopped. I really thought I was gone. You could have trusted me. These are bad people, Luca. They won't stop until they get what they want. And they don't care who gets hurt in the process. Then what do we do? We have to stop them.
Joseph slumped into the cold, wet snow.
They can't be stopped. This is too big. I tried beating them at their own game, done fighting fire with fire.
For the first time in a long time, her voice felt like her own again.
No more lies. I see now there's a better way to stop perennial harvest. The cold, hard truth.
Luca gazed down at Nuncreed with pity. He looked small. Joseph stared into the snow, as if searching it for answers.
Come on, everyone. We've got a party to crash. I wonder if this is the true ending. And then... Oh. You don't understand. He always wins.
Chapter 9.
I mean, it's possible that the game could, like, we could technically reach the end of the story, but then be able to go back and complete another path to learn some additional information. I'm not sure.
The devil you know.
The devil you know is, I don't remember the other part of the saying.
7 months ago.
7 months ago.
Eleanor Van Horn crept down the maze of sterile hallways under Perennial Harvest. She stopped in front of the large steel door marked Deep Engineering. No turning back now. She raised a trembling hand. The stolen keycard worked as promised, and the door buzzed open with mechanical efficiency. She was immediately hit with the smell of disinfectant. It was some sort of laboratory. In one corner was a desk covered in papers. Across the room stood a tall metal pod with hoses protruding from its base. She rushed to the desk and began shifting through the piles of papers. They were experiment reports on something called Tempest Liquamen. There were dozens of them, every one stamped failed. Eleanor heard the sharp echo of footsteps approaching. She was out of time. Her eyes scanned the room, eventually landing on the strange pod. Muttering a curse under her breath, she dashed over and dove inside.
And that is what change is all about. Grabbing the future by the balls, I mean the scruff of the neck, and making things happen. Change is a choice. I am tickled pink that we will all be making that choice together. How great is that? This man is a liar! Excuse me? I will not. This town has a dangerous secret, and Perennial Harvest only exists to keep it hidden. Nonsense. They picked up the whole damn town and moved it right under our noses. You aren't making any sense, dear.
Mr. Kerr addressed the crowd with a sarcastic tone.
Imagine such a thing. It's absurd and just plain impossible. They promised they could fix the foul harvest. They told us they would clean this place up. We just had to leave town for a few days. But while they had us evacuated... Miss Hartford, I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask you to... You're afraid of a lot of things, aren't you? You sniveling little worm. This is growing tiresome. A little help, please? Don't you all see this? Festival is a sham! An excuse to have the whole town gather in one place. They're planning something awful! I don't know what, but these people are wicked. Don't listen to her. She has absolutely no proof. I am the proof. I'm Eleanor Van Horn.
Whispers filtered through the crowd.
Well, aren't you just sneaky as the dickens? We all knew Valentine's fertilizer was too good to be true. And now this whole town is paying the price. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm so sorry about this disruption. My associates will take this obviously disturbed woman somewhere comfortable so that she can get the help she needs. She's not the one who's disturbed. You two-timing clown. You all know there's something wrong with this town. It was just easier to look the other way. The truth is... That's quite enough, Mr. Nuncreed.
Torment dragged on Joseph Nuncreed's face.
Yes, sir. Take them away. No, I want them to see this. Ah, the ever tempestuous Eleanor Van Horn. You've been quite the thorn in my side. Alright, you know, you're not gonna tell me that she got old and he got young? Is that where they're going with this? Did he steal her youth? Or did the experiment go wrong? Like a weed that's burrowed in where it doesn't belong. I must confess, you look dreadful.
He paused for a moment, plucking a piece of fuzz from his sweater and discarding it to the ground.
Consider yourself in rare company. You've managed to pull one over on me. It won't happen again. I knew you had some sort of plan to disrupt our little party. But alas, I expected something a bit more impressive than incoherent rambling. No matter, your failures are yours to bear. Mr. Kerr? Yes, sir? It's a shame it was cut short, but I thank you for your rousing oratory. I will take it from here. Yes, sir. Of course, sir. You've done quality work for me, William. You can look forward to the recompense we agreed upon.
Kerr gave a bow of deference.
Founder, you are most gracious.
Gasps rippled through the crowd.
Yep. Thankfully, we can dispense with the formalities from here on out.
Solomon pulled a glass vial from his pocket. In one smooth motion, he downed its contents. A triumphant smile grew across Solomon's lips.
You can call me Sharper Valentine.
His body and face began to contort and expand as he disappeared into a belching green mist. A hushed horror gripped the crowd.
Yep.
This is a story about change.
What? No! Ah, so you didn't see that coming. Actually, I did see it coming about 5 minutes ago. Or 2 minutes ago. Good.
Sharper examined his new hands.
Well, this is quite the improvement. Everything looks so much smaller now. Eleanor was right about one thing. This festival was a ruse. I wanted you all to witness my glorious return with your own eyes. Why does everyone look so downtrodden? This is a celebration, people. Maybe it would help if we set the mood. Mr. Kerr, be a dear and reveal the sign. Finally! Sharper what? Ha! Wonderful! That is... I thought they edited the sign. Or... Wait. Who edited the sign? I can't remember now. I mean, it was a bunch of kids. Was it him as a kid, though? I don't remember who the group of kids were. I believe it was three kids at night, and they said they messed with the sign. Well, I thought they made it funny, but...
Sharper choked out a crude squawk of a laugh. Frustrated grumbles sprinkled through the crowd.
Sharper, you malicious bastard! Malice. I'm glad you're back so you can tell you to your face. You destroyed this town. We ain't gonna let you get away with it again.
Sorry, this is not the time for audience participation. Some assistance, Mr. Kerr.
William Kerr gave a subtle nod to the clipboards.
You coward!
Does anyone else have something to contribute?
A helpless quiet settled over the crowd.
I thought so. Did you all truly believe you could be free of me? A town of complete and utter fools. You people should be celebrating my return. You're clearly lost without me. And that leads me nicely to my children. Daddy? Oh, finally the depressed mayor perks up. I give you both the greatest gift a parent can give. The opportunity to prove yourselves in my absence. Squandered. To say I'm disappointed would be an understatement. But I... Silence, Augustus. An adult is speaking. I don't know which is worse. A son is completely hopeless. Or a daughter with such potential who inevitably lets me down. Heiress, you fail me with admirable consistency. Thankfully, I was counting on it this time. Father, I have been wasting my time, dear. What have you accomplished? I was focused on cementing our legacy. Legacy? Who needs a legacy when you can just live forever? But what about... It's all right, kiddo. I'm afraid you suffer from a complete lack of imagination. There's just no helping it. Now then, where's Joseph? You didn't take the opportunity to slip off, did you? Ah, there he is. Everyone should give him a hand. None of this would have been possible without Joseph. I think you've said enough. Nonsense. The people deserve to know how helpful and loyal you've been. I only did what I did because he left me no choice. You always had a choice, Joseph. You were simply too weak to take it. No matter. Cheer up. You're about to be rich beyond your wildest dreams. You should follow Mr. Kerr's example. When I found him, he was in a sorrier state than any of you. An aging actor, desperate to recapture his youth. He played his part, and soon he'll be able to play the leading man again. Forever, in fact, if he remains loyal. That goes for all of you. Well, those who haven't already frittered away my goodwill. Beacon Pines is mine again. And I am willing to share its spoils in exchange for absolute loyalty.
Are you saying William Kerr was never in charge of Perennial Harvest?
Ha! Huh. You think that puffed up blatherskite could have accomplished all this? Dawn, I suppose it's time for your big exclusive.
Sharper addressed the crowd with indignant pride. He'd planned this moment for so long that now, at the deed's fruition, it almost felt frivolous.
You see, I needed a figurehead to hold things down while I orchestrated my return. Someone to misdirect, lie, and bilk this town for a spell. So I invented William Kerr. Take your bow. You've earned it.
Mr. Kerr flourished a preposterously elaborate bow.
Patrick C. Montesquieu, thespian extraordinaire, at your service. Founder, I just want to thank you again for this opportunity. It truly was the role of a lifetime. Wait.
Oh my god. So this Kerr was a patsy the whole time. The end.
Your secret is out in the open. What's to stop this town from rising up against you? Oh, that's the delicious part. Yeah. Thanks to our clipboards, I know what each and every person in this town fears the most. And I will make those fears manifest for anyone who steps out of line. The choice is simple.
I'm not afraid of you.
Ha, the young hero. I've kept a keen eye on you, boy. You and your friends made a habit of disrupting my plans. What a pity if things would have gone a bit differently. You might have had your moment of triumph. But that's fate for you.
You can't do this.
Oh, but I can. I have won. Never underestimate what a great man can do given time. And now time is my plaything. Perhaps the most expensive thing I've ever bought. But well worth it. Ha!
Sharper coughed up one final laugh and cracked his knuckles.
Enough chit-chat. Let's get to work, shall we?
And so, Sharper set about remaking the town in his own image. The fertilizer factory soon reopened for business. Sales rose steadily, as more and more farmers across the countryside began to swear by its miraculous properties. Beacon Pines became famous. A secretive town that, for the right price, shared its gifts with all. Gifts that became more and more necessary in a world where winters grew longer and longer. The end.
So the source remains active and is causing the planet to cool. I don't know. I assume they're using it as like a power source of some kind.
This is wrong, but things are becoming clearer now. You can feel it, right? We can't let Sharper win. He might just be the key to this whole thing. Let's see.
Fire and ice.
Yep, that's what I figured. That's the branch. Malice. And let's see, are there any other...
is another potential branch here. So I have to go here, learn something, and then maybe I can finish up there. But that suggests that I have another option besides humming and weeping? Interesting. All right. Ah! Who's scanning me? Ah, no! Ah! Hello, Hanasaku. Why does my stream just say one person is watching constantly? Even though Cage came in and... Let's see. Nope, still says one viewer. That's weird. I don't know. It's like Twitch is not updating. Because that one viewer should be me, because I'm watching my own stream. Anyway, hello! We are quickly approaching the end of this game. Yeah, so if you haven't played this game and you want to, you might not want to watch the ending of it. I think there might be like another hour in the game at this point. But it's a cool game. It's a very it's a strongly story-based game with a lot of intrigue and mystery, and it's not like a puzzle game. There are no puzzles to do. It's a very super casual game. So it's almost basically telling a story. there's no real gameplay in it. You do walk around and look for things and interact with them, but yeah, it's mostly following along with the story, but the story is really interesting and fun and got good characters, so it's fun to play. Yeah. I decided to play it because it looked like it was not a very long game either. It looked like it was about 6 hours long. How long have I been doing it now for? I think I streamed for 4 hours yesterday and 3 hours the day before. That's 7. Yeah, well, maybe it's a little bit longer than 6 hours, but might be closer to 9 hours. But anyway, I'm going to continue on with this. The way the game works, by the way, is you as you go around the environment and do things, you get verbs that you can use. So where it says there was a blank lurking behind those eyes, the first time I had the verb shame that I was able to use, and now I have the verb malice, which I can use, and that will give me a different branch. I can basically change what happened. But anyway, I'm going to continue with this, and so look away if you don't want to be spoiled.
There was a malice lurking behind those eyes. Like a trap ready to spring. Luca felt the weight of Nuncrete's hand on his shoulder. Something wasn't right. He didn't know why, but something was telling Luca to get out of there.
I just want this to all be over. Of course, I'm sure it will all work out soon enough. I should get going.
I told Roxy I'd check for Rolo at the treehouse.
Luca twisted free of Nuncreed's grasp.
Of course. Luca. You know your dad and I were good friends back in the day. You can come to me with anything. Anything at all. Mm-hmm. Run! These festival decorations are a bit humdrum. Now, if I were to throw a festival, it would be a thing to behold. I agree, this is all more than a little sad. It's worse than sad. It's boring. What if we did a little something to spice things up? I'm listening. You know that festival sign? Oh, yeah, this is what happened before. It would be a shame if someone...
The two scurried off, eagerly formulating a plan.
Wait, why are you going that way when the festival sign is... this way? Identify yourself, please. Telly Modewill. I work here now. I am unable to locate you on our staff roll. Oh, I don't officially start until tomorrow. Mr. Kerr said I could come in early tonight to get a few things done. Hold, please. Clearance authorized. Thank you. Our harvest awaits.
Wow. You could get a wrench up to the noggin sneaking up on a guy like that. Don't scare a man while he's junkin', sonny.
Evening, Jeff. Isn't it kinda late to be junkin'? Might as well ask the same thing you. Find anything good?
Bah. Ever since perennial harvest moved in, even the junk is trash. You can learn a lot about a person by looking at what they throw away. With this bunch is all shredded paper and coffee cups.
Oh, I better get going. I didn't see nothing. If you didn't see nothing.
See what? Exactly. Howdy, Luca.
Hello again, Pete.
I'm not Pete, you silly goose. It's Toby.
You could have fooled me.
Well, hey, it's no problemo.
Important thing is, we'd love to hear your thoughts.
Yeah, I'm getting that impression. We're all part of something special, Luca. And it all starts right here in Beacon Pines. I got it.
Toby looked up from the clipboard excitedly.
That's right.
So how about you start by telling me? Look, no offense, but I got my own stuff to take care of.
Aw, you joker. We're all part of this together.
You'll let us know when you're free to answer a few questions. Bop, bop.
I can't talk? Why would you even put this kid here if I can't talk to them?
Oh. Hey, Jensen. You seen Rolo come this way by chance? Afraid not. As elusive as the fish in this here pond. So, I probably have some new... herbs that I can use here. No, I don't. Damn.
I got like a whole ton of these things all at once. And then,
I haven't gotten anything since. Oh, didn't mean to do that.
Luca gently baited a feather for skimming the surface.
So I got all these things over here. Maybe that's all of them. So we can use some new bait. What do you say we head out and find some more? It does look like we could use some new bait, but where do I get new bait? Wait, what's that?
How do I get new bait? Rolo?
He aired a long holler into the woods.
Rolo! Sigh. Rolo, wherever you are, I hope you're okay.
Luca felt his eyes getting heavy and plopped into the beanbag. He conceded to its lumpy embrace. Once again, Luca found himself in a vast black expanse. This time, he knew exactly where to go. He took a single confident step forward. The world flickered and pulsed. He found himself standing in front of the frigid air of a blazing campfire. The source.
Oh. One moment.
He plopped down cross-legged and gazed into the cold flame, waiting. Soon enough, the fire began to die out, popping sporadically, until all that was left was a single ember. Luca stood up and dusted himself off. He plucked the glowing ember from the cold ash, examined it, and slid it into his pocket, a keepsake. The voice of his father spoke behind him. You made me proud, Buckaroo. Luca turned to face him. Dad, what is this place? A warm grin grew across his father's face. A place where everything that has been and everything that could be all wait together. Luca found himself staring at his father's face, trying as hard as he could to memorize every single detail. Wait? For what? Another voice spoke out as Luca's doppelganger stepped forward. That's up to you. Without knowing why, Luca began to weep. Is any of this real? Are you real? Luca's father bent down to smudge away a tear. Of course. I'm as real as the part of you that misses me. Luca turned to look at the older version of himself. And you? The doppelganger choked back tears. I'm as real as the part of you that's angry he's gone. Does that make sense? Through his tears, Luca laughed. I think so. His father pulled him in for an embrace. Time to go, Buckaroo. Luca was startled from his dream by a banging on the floor.
Are you in there?
A commanding voice rumbled from below. Just as Luca sprang to lock the entry hatch, the door knocked open.
Oh dear.
Chapter 5. Dangers big and small. Luca stumbled back. He heard the rope ladder creak under significant weight. Keeping his eyes fixed on the hatch, he inched backward to the balcony. As his hand grasped the door handle, Luca froze. A large figure clumsily wriggled up through the hole.
Stop right there. Or I'll...
Sheesh, I know it's dark and all, but I figured you'd recognize me.
Who are you?
The large figure cocked its head inquisitively.
Stop now, or I'll clobber you with a baseball bat. Whoa, 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 take it easy. Luca, you need to get your eyes checked. It's me, Rolo. How did Rolo get older?
what?
Is he dreaming? His dreams before haven't played out like this. Nice try, but I know you aren't Rolo. You're like one of his random uncles or something. Where is he? Haha, uncle? Luca, quit messing around. It's me! If it really is you, prove it. Flaming chicken coop, Luca!
Luca's jaw dropped.
So did he drink something to get older like the other guy?
He peered more closely at the man standing in front of him. Something about him was undeniably Rolo. Only bigger, older, changed.
Ow! What happened to you? When I was running away, I ran into more people in those yellow suits. They grabbed me and dragged me away. When I was running away... I don't remember what happened in this branch. Like... I don't know if this branch was the one where we went to the... thing together, and then... I don't think that was that one, because we, There was a branch where Rolo was captured, and then he contacted me on the radio, and in that timeline, I'm trying to think. In that timeline, we ended up coming back here to the thing, and that was the one where the bully got mutated, right? I can't remember. What? Where did they take you? Dunno, they threw a bag over my head. It was cold and smelled like a swimming pool. Chlorine. I think it was an underground lab or something. They made my hands all big. Look.
Rolo proudly presented his hands to Luca.
Pretty sweet, right? I mean, it wouldn't be my first pick for a superpower. But beggars can't be choosers. Rolo, it just wasn't just your hands. My feet, too? Dang, Pa just made me new shoes. Wait, Luca, why are you so small?
Luca moved to the side and pointed Rolo to his reflection in the balcony window.
What the?
His hands shot up to his face.
Holy Toledo! Rolo, what did they do to you? They made me drink some sort of green crud. Ew. Actually, it wasn't too bad. It kind of tasted like licorice. Wait. Tasted like licorice. The kid liked eating licorice. And then I sort of smashed open my cage and escaped. Whoa, you smashed open a cage? Kinda. At least I think I did. It's all a bit of a blur. Hey, you in a cage? Who are these people? I don't know who did this to you, but we're gonna fix it. Fix it? This is awesome! Well, I'm just glad you're safe now. Look, you don't need to worry about me. I'm sure I get snatched, but look at it this way. I got snatched. I know where snatched people go. We may finally have a lead on what happened to your family. Maybe you're right, but this all seems dangerous. Danger? Ha!
Rollo shadowboxed a few jabs.
I'll take them all on! Hey, fellas, what's up?
With a yelp, Rollo dove behind Luca.
Ah! Take cover! Did I come up at a bad time? Who the heck are you? This is Beck. Sorry, something truly bizarre just happened and I need help. I didn't know where else to go. So you're just hanging out here with your large adult friend? Ah, no, this is my buddy Rollo. This is your missing friend. One of the same. He seems a little old. All you know, this is a recent development. What the heck does that mean? Oh, I'm sorry. You're the one who just showed up out of nowhere. So we'll be asking the questions here. That's fair. How did you find us? Your silly little treehouse? I think you mean our silly little mission control. I hate to break it to you, but your secret path isn't so secret. And I could hear your racket from a mile away. See, Luca, this is why we need to improve security around here. Not now, Rollo. Beck, you said something bizarre happened? Yeah, but...
She shot a nervous glance at Rollo.
Anything you can say around me, you can say around Rollo. This has been a weird day all around, hasn't it? Yep.
Beck's eyes narrowed.
Okay, so it all started when I made it back home. My first order of business was to try and salvage my hair. Oh. Okay, so this is the timeline where I used Tickle on the bully. And the bully's friend ran off. And the bully splashed goo onto the hair of Beck. And their hair aged and turned gray. And I guess this was also the timeline where Rollo Rollo came with me to the warehouse. And we hid in the dumpster. And then he left first and got snatched. And then I left, and we were just hearing him on walkie-talkies for a bunch of time, and now he's just shown up. So I doubt it was some stuff from the chemistry set my mom gave me. That doesn't seem very safe. Okay. I just need to play it cool. I hope no one notices. Notices what? Oh, nothing. I was just... Come over here and let me have a look. Okay, honey, what in the world did you do to your hair? I just kind of felt like a change. This is going to take forever to grow out. You were the one who said that change was a good thing, right? I was talking about your mother's new job. Talking about us moving. Well, I guess I just took your lesson to heart.
Ilona tried to put on a smile.
Before I forget, I came up here to tell you that Nellie had to go into work. Tonight? Her and Mr. Kerr decided it would be good for her to get some things done before tomorrow. That Kerr guy seems like a grade A creep. Beck. He is! Him and his weird cult of personality? You are not going to ruin this job for Nellie. It means too much to her. Oh, I know exactly how much it means to her. It means enough for her to exile her daughter to this podunk town. This place sucks. The
people are weird. You just don't know them yet. It's always cold. We're in the mountains. You'll get used to it. I can't even pick up a single decent station on the radio. It's all banjo music and farm records. You know, I grew up in a town not that different from this one. Is that why you're better at talking to plants than people? Okay. So here's what we're gonna do. First of all, you're grounded. What? In the morning, I'll have Nelly come and see what we can do about fixing your hair. You need to look presentable for the festival. What's wrong with her hair? It's just blue. But not another peep.
She sighed, and after a moment, looked down at Beck sympathetically.
I know moving is hard, honey. But that doesn't mean you have to make yourself miserable all the time. Other people seem to have that covered for me. Oh, and if you decide to rebel by dyeing your hair more?
She flashed a sly grin and tussled Beck's hair.
I'll just shave it off for you. Think of how rebellious you'll look then. Like a bald cat. Very funny. Thank you. Good night, sweetie. Good night, Mom. Wait, wait, wait. First of all, this town does not suck. Second, you need help because you get grounded. No. I'm sorry you got in trouble. It's my fault your hair got screwed up in the first place. Don't worry about it. I kind of actually like this look. Great. Can we get back to the story now? The next part is the important bit. I have this radio I upgraded with my mom, and I was too angry to sleep. So I tried to dial in something. Worth listening to. Mr. Kerr, are you there? Mr. Kerr? Yes, I'm busy. What is it? Apologies. I have the founder on the line. Patch him through immediately. One moment. Hello, sir. It's so nice to hear from you. Skip the pleasantries. What's your report on our new lead researcher of deep engineering? Nelly Modewell seems to be integrating nicely. At this very moment, she's working to help us meet our deadline. She offered to work overtime before I even had the chance to suggest it. Excellent. And you have faith that she's capable of finishing the work left by her predecessor? Her work must be complete before the festival. I will make sure she stays day and night until it's accomplished. Good. You know how I feel about the loose ends. Yes, sir. Once she has finished the work, we need to make a determination regarding her long-term prospects in the company. Immediately, sir? I usually have more time to bring people into the fold. We are in the endgame, Bill. After your failures with Dr. Prescott, I can't afford to take any risks. Of course, sir. No loose ends, sir. Once she finishes the work, she will either leave the office completely committed to the perennial harvest, or she won't leave at all. Perfect. Sir, if I might suggest, Maybe we should delay just for a bit. Oh? It's just, we seem to be rushing to hit this festival deadline. And rushing into things has caused some issues in the past. I see. Please understand that I just want what's best for you. I'm eternally grateful for all that you've done for me. Bill, I'll make this very clear for you. I brought you in to make things run smoothly, not to have opinions. Of course, sir. Cheer up, Bill. Only a few days away from having everything ever dreamed of. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Whoa. Yeah. Just so we're clear, when they said loose ends, we're talking about murder, right? Like, actually killing someone? Capital murder?
Luca gave Rollo a quick elbow to the ribs.
Who is this founder?
I don't know.
Nice. As far as we know, Kerr is the top banana at Perennial Harvest. He sounded scared of this founder guy. So we have an even topper banana on the field. What the hell is my mom caught up in? Has she talked about the job much? Not really. She said she was going to come in and continue the work of someone she respected. Luca, do you think that body at the warehouse was the person's Beck's mom came to replace? That would make sense. Beck, it seems like Nellie's predecessor got, loose-ended. I'm getting that impression. So we need to get your mom out of there before the festival happens. That's 2 days away. Won't she just come home after work? The creep on the radio said they're gonna hold her until then. So if she's not coming out, we gotta go in and get her.
Beck flicked a large sheet of paper out of her pocket and slammed it on the floor.
Maybe this will help. You have blueprints? Well, it's really just a welcome map for my mom's PH orientation day. That shows the layout. Sure looks like blueprints to me. Look, here's the reception area. There's a big room marked Founder's Office. It even has the exits marked. Guys. We have a deadline. We have an objective. We have blueprints. You realize what this is, right?
I started to wiggle with excitement.
It's a heist. I think we're heisting. This is officially a heist!
Chapter 6. The Heist. They spent the night's end huddled around that small map, formulating a plan to infiltrate the headquarters of Perennial Harvest. It would be no small feat, a modern facility equipped with all manner of technology. Not to mention the swarm of clipboards that would most certainly be scattered throughout. By the time the sun began to peek through the car window used as a makeshift balcony door, all were in agreement. This could just work. The final day before the festival would be used to prepare. They'd need to pull every resource at their disposal, pull every favor with a thread. Even enlist some unsavory characters around town with important tasks only they were suited for. Luckily, there was enough ill will and mistrust toward Perennial Harvest that alliances could be found at a bargain. Luca, Beck, and Rollo rubbed their eyes as they exited the treehouse. They hadn't slept at all that night. There was no time. The festival was to begin in 1 day, and they each had their assignments.
All right, quick recap. Rollo, you're gonna talk to Roxy. Cordially.
Without her and Fitz, this whole thing could go bust. Me, Cordial is my middle name. And how do you plan to explain your new
vaguely at Rollo's sizable figure?
Circumstance. She'll be so happy I'm alive she won't even notice.
Beck snorted an involuntary giggle.
And Beck, you're sure Ilona won't just shoot this whole thing down when she hears it? She'll listen. Once she understands the danger Nelly is in, the danger we're all in, the plan will make sense. Okay. That leaves me with Jeff and Iggy. How are you gonna persuade them? I'll think of something.
They each looked at each other with sleepy confidence and nodded.
Well, Godspeed. I think this is actually going to take more than an hour to finish. Maybe I should leave the remainder of this for another stream. I've been at it for about 3 hours. I don't think it'll end in another hour. Probably gonna be another 2 hours, actually. I guess I'll call it here, actually. So, since there's doesn't appear to be anybody in chat right now, I'll just call it end the stream and no raid. So good night, everybody. Bye bye.